man. Let's face the music and dance. Before the fiddlers have fled, before they ask us to pay the bill, and while we still have the chance, let's face the music and dance. Soon we'll be without the moon, humming a different tune, and then there may be teardrops to shed. So while there's moonlight and music and love and romance, face the music and dance.
Staff hearing officer, and I call the meeting of Wednesday, April 2nd to order. Today we have four items on our agenda, and I haven't received any requests for continuances or withdrawals, so I'm going to hear them in the order that they appear on the agenda. Under item B, announcements and appeals, I don't have any announcements, and we have no appeals. So we'll move on to comments from members of the public. Is there anybody in the audience who would like to address the staff hearing officer on items not on today's agenda? No, seeing no one, we'll go to the first item, which is 529 La Marina Drive. If the applicant would like to come up. Oh, sorry, 527 La Marina.
I didn't move.
You knew what I meant because you came up.
Yeah, it's worked.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, so this is a project on Mesa, and it's an existing one-story residence. And currently, it has a two-story one-story garage.
Oh, the button on the inside.
Okay, so currently this is a one-story residence, single-family residence with a two-car garage. And the eave of the garage encroaches slightly into the required interior setback. It was built that way. As you know, our ordinance allows for eaves to encroach 2 feet. This encroaches an additional 1 foot for a total of 3 feet encroachment. So the applicant is proposing to build a second story addition over the existing garage, and the same portion of the eave will be encroaching the additional 1 foot into the required interior setback. It will not be any greater encroachment than currently is there. It just will be on the second story rather than on the first story. There's no additional square footage within the setback. We feel it has a minimal impact to the neighbors. And staff supports the approval of a modification. And as part of this project, they are removing some violations that were noted in the ZIR, and there's going to be new decking, but it will all be outside of the setback. So other than the small encroachment, everything else about the project conforms to the current zoning ordinance. So do you have any questions?
Okay, great, thank you. Mm-hmm. Would you like to state your name for the record and provide additional comments?
Paul Rubel, no, I'm just here to answer questions.
Okay, great. Thank you. I don't have any questions at this time, but I'll open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to address the staff hearing officer on this item? No? Kathy, did we receive any letters or correspondence? Okay, so I'll close the public hearing. I agree with staff's recommendation. The amount of encroachment is very small. As she stated, although this whole area encroaches into the setback, there's really only a small portion that exceeds what is currently allowed, and it is an eave. It's not square footage. It's not habitable space. It's not going to cause any additional impacts to the adjacent neighbor. So I'm comfortable with approving the project. I know you show that the violations that were noted in the previous ZIR is being abated. I just want to put a condition on there just to make sure it's carried forward with this permit. So
sure.
It would just be that the condition or the zoning and building code violations that were outlined in the previous EIR will be abated with this application. Is that okay?
Sure.
Okay. Great. So with that added condition, I can make the findings outlined in the staff report and approve your project. My approval is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days. They also have oversight authority of all my actions, and if they felt this warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during the same 10-day appeal period, and if either of that would occur, Betsy would contact you.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay.
Great, thanks.
Thanks.
The next item is 202 La Plata, if the applicant would like to come up.
I also have a graphic that helps with the photos.
So, this project is located at 202 La Plata on the corner of La Plata and Calle Breville. Currently, the house is oriented so that it does take access off of La Plata. As a part of this project, we are reorienting the front door so that it faces Calle Breville. Demolishing an existing one-car garage that's highlighted in pink in the upper right-hand corner. We are demolishing a detached storage shed that was called out as a violation in the zoning information report. We're removing an existing driveway that is coming off of La Plata. When this house was originally built, it did have a one-car garage in this location, which was legally converted to habitable space. And at that time, they did not remove that driveway and parking pad in front of the garage. So that's a part of the project as well. They're doing a small 38 square foot addition to the master bathroom to slightly enlarge that as a part of the project right there. The project is here before you because it requires a open yard modification. This property is located in the E3SB3 zone. And in the single family zones, we are required to have an open yard of 1,250 square feet with a dimension of no less than 20 feet. If you were to look at the existing site plan, you can see that they have a very small non-conforming open yard because we're 6 feet at this portion. You would count this 6 foot wide portion and this little area in this area. As their open yard, in this area here would have a dimension of 19 by 23. Currently, that's the largest, most conforming portion of their open yard. They are reducing that area to 14 by 19 with the construction of the new two-car garage. But they, with the removal of this driveway, are capturing a lot of new open yard over here. So the graphic that she just brought to you shows the location of the proposed open yard, which does total 1,250. It does not have the required dimension of 20 feet in every direction. So that is the exception that we're asking for. This will be the secondary yard, and we're allowed to have an open yard within the front setback as long as it's back 10 feet from the front property line. So we do have 1250, and overall we are improving the site with the two-car garage, which staff has supported reductions in open yard to provide off street parking. Now I have some conditions that I added on here. So as conditions, staff has recommended that the required 1250 square feet open yard be shown on the building permit set of plans. With the removal of the driveway off of La Plata, a public works permit would be required for any work within the right-of-way. And they need to submit that application. That's my second condition. And then submit an application to Public Works Department for a change of address to Calle Breville, because we're now taking access off Calle Breville. And that the storage shed, which was a violation in the zoning information report at the time of sale, be demolished. So those were the four conditions that I have recommended. And I recommend that you approve the project.
Okay, great. Would you like to state your name for the project, or for the record, and have additional comments?
Sure. My name is Michelle McToldridge. I'm the architect for the project. I'd just like to add that it's a really small lot, and it is on a corner, so it does have the kind of the burden of two front yard setbacks, which wouldn't have been an issue if it wasn't a corner. In addition, we had the option of considering non-compliant location of open yard because we do have all this lawn space that is usable open yard, but because of the removal of this driveway and a fence that we're putting in here, we thought it might be better to just focus on non-conforming dimensions of open yard in compliant spaces. So there is just a lot of new open yard space, and the photos show this place is just covered in concrete. It's a very odd lot, and a lot of that is just coming out, and we're making usable outdoor spaces that it's going to be a really nice improvement to this lot without. We're staying at a single story. We're making a compliant garage. We're coming out of these setbacks. So overall, it's just a great improvement to this neighborhood. So we're hoping that you can, agree with us on the open yard accommodation here.
Okay. And then in terms of building additions, there's more than just back here, right? You're popping out the front.
There's a little pop out here that does stay behind the front yard setback.
Okay. And then relocating the fireplace.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's all within?
All of that's within the...
And with the relocated garage, you're cutting out some of them.
You can see, yes,
some,
we are bringing
all.
It down a little bit because mm-hmm. this is a very steep, awkward driveway where mm-hmm. cars will bottom out. So by bringing it down a little bit, it's a more usable drive. People don't actually use that drive so much. They still are parking on the old mm-hmm. Driveway that was supposed to be demolished many years ago. So that's coming out now.
Okay. I'm just speaking to that new driveway. They're reutilizing the existing narrow curb cut. If you can see, the edge of the driveway comes across here.
Mm-hmm.
It widens out at this point, not at the front.
Yeah, right, so now there's a retaining wall all the way up to here, so we're just going to widen it out so you can actually
make the maneuvers.
Make the back out of a two-car garage.
This would be a new retainer wall, and this
yes.
will be replanted with grass?
Grass and low shrubs or so. Okay. Something that can be driven over if it needs to be, but it's just less... impervious mm-hmm. surfaces, which this lot is covered with right now. So we're just pulling out a lot of concrete.
Okay. And then another item I wanted to point out. There's notes on this plan, but I didn't have a note plan sheet in mind. I don't know if there's something here, but this dotted line, I'm assuming it's an awning.
Yes.
It might have to be reduced in width because it's approached 2 feet instead of 3 feet. So that might be just something just to let you know. In terms
which the
of
previous one just pointed out, the 2 foot max into the
yeah, so
yard.
That might be something in plan. It's nothing
sure.
related to the mods, but when I was looking, trying to figure out
mm-hmm.
what the layout was.
Okay.
So those are my questions for right now. I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to address the staff on this item? Have we received any comments or calls?
I have not.
So I'll close the public hearing. I went out to the site and agree there's a lot of concrete on the property. And looking at the area where the proposed garage is going, because in reality, on paper, this is your largest area that meets it, and staff pointed out in the staff report. So I was looking to see how usable it is. I realize this shed is in the area, and which was added, it's inconsistent with zoning. But when you look at the current situation, this doesn't show an existing situation, but this is elevated from here. And so although it looks like it's all contiguous, it's really not usable as one complete area, and it is all paved right now. I don't know her pretty pictures here.
And one of them shows an area.
This is that shed in the lower area, and then it popped
so here,
up to this.
Here's the area we're talking about where mm-hmm. it's all concrete, and then that's the shed, and then there's actually a ramp or steps going down. So mm-hmm. it's not really functional as it exists today. And I understand corner lots are constrained because they have the two front yards. So in the typical development, if this is your front yard, you would have this area, which would meet the requirement. And we are now amending our hedge and fence ordinance, which would allow a higher fence actually to the property line. Still, per ordinance, this area mm-hmm. 10 feet back could only be counted, but it would provide for a nice outdoor area.
Mm-hmm.
So I agree with staff's recommendation in terms of the reduced or the non-conforming open yard area, recognizing areas that
don't currently meet our minimum dimensions. I have concerns regarding really the usability of this 6-foot area because it's mainly just walkways. It's not really usable as open space, but I can balance that against the fact that there is areas that, although technically don't meet our code standard in terms of location, it functions as an open area right now, and there is an existing house on the lot that's going to be remaining. So I could support the project and make the findings outlined in the staff report subject to the conditions that staff proposed, and I don't believe I need to add any additional conditions. The awning, that will just be taken care of in plan check, and so that doesn't need to be a condition. So approve your project, making the findings subject to those conditions. My action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days, and they also have oversight authority of all my actions, and if they felt this warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during that same 10-day appeal period, and if either of those were to occur, Suzanne would contact you.
Okay? Okay, great. Thank you.
I'm going to keep going.
Keep that.
The next project is 561 Aurora Avenue, if the applicant would like to see it.
Good morning.
Hi.
So the project here at 561 Arroyo is located on a 7,433 square foot lot in the Hillside Design District, and it's currently developed with a single family residence about 1,100 square feet with an attached 410 square foot two car garage. The applicant is proposing a 220 square foot addition between the garage and the main house to add a small room, bathroom, and laundry area, requiring an interior setback modification. When the house was constructed, the setback requirement was 5 feet. It was downzoned in 1975, which increased the setback requirement to 10 feet. So this orange dashed line that's showing here is showing that approximate location of a 10-foot setback. If we go to, this is the existing elevations. You can see the covered breezeway at the top that connects the garage and the residence. And this is the location of the proposed new room between the garage and the main house. As you can see, it has the bathroom with a small window located in the required setback, and then a like a linen cabinet and area for the washer and dryer. I guess I got that backwards. Since the room is located off the garage, this room cannot be used for a bedroom or sleeping purposes. So I have added a recommended condition. It's a building code requirement, but the reason why we are not allowing it to be a bedroom is because of this door here. If that were removed at a future date, it might be used as a bedroom. These are the roof plans so that you can kind of see how the new roof will integrate into the existing roof. And then the affected elevations are shown here. This is the elevation that will be seen from the adjacent neighbor, the side that's encroaching into the setback. And that is the east elevation that is viewed as you pull into the driveway and enter the front of the, or the side of the house. Okay. And I don't think I have any other recommended conditions. Oh, if you look in the photographs, there's a water softener currently located in the breezeway. I had a brief discussion.
And a water heater.
Yeah, I had a brief discussion with Mr. Given about these two appliances needing to be relocated. He briefly discussed with me that he had an idea of putting them in the garage.
Yeah, tankless water heater.
Yeah, tankless water heater and the water softener in the front corner of the garage, where you have that slight offset between the garage door and the actual physical interior wall. I have advised him that he will need to check with transportation. So I simply added a condition in the staff report that they would need to be relocated to a conforming location. If the fixtures are proposed to be located within the non-conforming garage, the applicant shall obtain a transportation design waiver at the garage dimensions. And with that, staff is recommending approval of the setback encroachment.
Okay, great, thank you. Would you like to state your name for the record and add additional comments?
Yeah, my name is Kenneth Given. I'm the owner. Mm-hmm. The main reason we're doing this is to move the laundry room from the garage to free up that space for, you know, cars and such. And also to, the house is pretty small. We have one main living area where, you know, there's a TV and stuff. This would be kind of maybe a little like a reading room too, something like that, where we could just kind of sit quietly and read and stuff like that when someone's in the other room. Just kind of free up a little bit of space. Not to mention the fact that it would reduce some of the noise that our neighbors might hear when we go in and out of the house, going back and forth to the garage to do laundry and things like that. So.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to open the public hearing. Is there anyone here who would like to address the staff and answer? After you speak, if you could fill out a speaker form for Rebecca.
I looked over there.
Oh, you didn't see me? Okay.
Good
morning.
Good morning. My name is Don Gregg. I'm acting as agent for Mike and Diane Greenwood. They're the neighbor nearest to them on this side right here at 557, I believe, is the address.
Okay.
The concern that they have is they did an addition a couple years ago, and they were required to pull it every new structure back to 10 foot to protect this property, and that was just a requirement of that was not an option. They were not able to get a modification. So 2 years, 3 years later, now they're able to get a modification to move close to them. They had their project that protected this one. It's important to note that their master bedroom is what's closest to this property right here. The concern that they had.
It doesn't show adjacent footprint, sorry.
Their master bedroom would go right here, and they've had to pull theirs back 10 foot from the property. It's interesting that they say that it was 5 foot, because when I was the designer for this, the city at that time showed that the old setback was 8 foot, and then we had to increase it to 10 foot in the 1975. So I don't know if that's an issue or not, and that could be wrong. But the issue is, if they put this here, there's a window there, and also part of the plan is to have a washer and dryer, and the dryer is going to vent. And with it being 5 foot from the property line, that all the lint is going to go right up into their bedroom window. And so their issue is they are not opposed to doing some kind of project there. If you look at the roof line, the way it sits now, it sets back. It looks like it would be a much nicer look anyway if it just followed the existing roof line with that breezeway instead of bumping it all the way out to the property line. But if you do bump it out to the property line, if they could take away the window and make sure that there's no venting for that dryer that's going to blow all the lint up in their bedroom, and then also he places his trash in this area here, and we're worried that what's to stop him once it's approved and all the inspectors are out, that trash goes back right underneath their bedroom windows again, where it is now.
So does that mean that they're going to remove the 8 or 9 cans that they keep over there?
Okay, this isn't appropriate venue for that.
Okay.
Is that all your?
Yes, that's my comments.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else who would like to address the staff hearing officer on this item? Nope. Seeing no one, have we received any other
correspondence? Okay. Currently, the dryer does vent right here already. So all we would be doing was moving the vent that way about 2 feet.
Okay, but the dryer is for the washer.
Coming
dryer
the
is
garage.
Not in there with a permit, right?
Right.
Okay. All right. So did I close the public hearing? I went out to the site and did a site visit and looked around. Unfortunately, I'm not familiar with the project next door. I don't know if the modification was denied or just informed that they couldn't apply for it. I know with my history of doing the modifications, we come into this situation quite often where there's a non-conforming site that the existing buildings were built
to a setback that was years ago, and then the zone changed, and now they're non-conforming. We have that all over the city. And I see quite often people wishing to do a uniform improvement, so add on to the building and keep the line of existing building instead of jogging in. Most often it's someone wishing to add on to the back versus this is the garage is existing 5 feet and the house is existing and they're filling in the area between. And so I believe in terms of the building addition and filling in the breezeway, that is an appropriate improvement. And I wasn't around in the 70s. I don't know what the history was for when the neighbor added on. But given today's reviews and today's standards, I think the enclosure of the breezeway makes the most sense in this situation, following the existing building outline. It would just end up a dead space, which would accumulate, potentially could accumulate stuff in this cutout area. Probably want some exterior access to get to it. I think that might cause more issues. So in terms of the building addition or the filling of that area, I think it is appropriate. And so then the next thing is what kind of openings are proposed in that area? When I see requests for interior setback modifications, I'm only aware of one instance that I allowed a door to be there because doors are disruptive to the neighbors. And you need a required light. I know they're supposed to be, the light's supposed to be directed towards the ground, but sometimes it's forgotten to be turned off. It just becomes a big issue. So I like the fact that there's no door approved in that area. In terms of the window, it is a small...
Fog bathroom window.
It's a small, it's not dimensioned out, but it's a small window. So in terms of noise associated with the window, I think that the noise, do you have the dimension?
I thought I had it in here, a small bathroom window.
The noise associated with that, it won't increase more. In terms of the building or the dryer vent, I don't know, you know, if there's other options in terms of venting. I know lint is produced when, from the dryer, but I don't know, given it's a single family home and the volume of laundry, that would be significant to cause a large plume of lint. So in terms of the impacts to the adjacent neighbor, I believe that the enclosure of this area, one, would reduce noise. It would potentially reduce lighting, because I'm assuming there's a light for the door. It might be shielded some of the window. Did you find the images of the window?
I know I saw it somewhere.
The window is going to be about yay long, about that high.
Well, we'll see what the plant is, 1/4 inch.
Hopefully it scales.
We'll see if that says 12 too.
No, it's not going to scale. This is disproportionate. This is only coming up to 7.5. So.
Okay, well, in terms of the window, I could add a condition that the window be a clear story window.
Okay.
And the smallest size necessary to provide adequate ventilation. So that way it would be raised up high versus a large window here. Just to make sure that it doesn't grow. But in terms of the building addition, I believe it is an appropriate improvement. It represents a uniform addition to your house. It reflects the current situation of the site. And so I could make the findings in the outlined in the staff report. Staff's proposing the condition one about the addition not be used as a bedroom. I'd like that also written on the site plan so that when future people come look at it, they'll see that it's not to be used as a bathroom. And then also the condition regarding the window.
I know I saw a dimension on this other blow-up of the floor plan. It's only 1'6" long, so it's smaller in proportion,
okay,
height-wise.
So I'll put the dimensions that are listed here.
That's wide. I don't know what the height is.
Okay. So then I'd add the condition regarding the window and then change or add to number one, just that the note be added to the plan. Are you okay with those conditions?
Yeah, no problem.
Okay. So I'll make the findings outlined in the staff report and approve the project subject to those, to the revised conditions. And my action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days. And appeals of my decisions are filed here at 630 Garden Street versus up at City Hall where all the other appeals are filed. They also have oversight authority of all my actions, and if they felt this warranted additional discussion before them, they could call it up during that same 10-day appeal period. And if that was to occur, Suzanne would contact you.
Okay.
Okay? Great, thanks.
By the way, the trash cans, we're going to move those to the backside, to the backyard.
Okay.
I'm going to build a fence here.
Closure.
All right.
Thank you.
Okay, so the next project is 1826 Lassitunas Road.
Yeah. Excuse me, if I can have you take the conversation out into the hall, please. Thank you. Proposal before you is 1826 East Las Tunas. It's a approximately 20,000 square foot lot in the Hillside Design District. The proposal before you is for a 903 square foot one-story addition to the existing one-story residence, including the conversion of the 675 square foot detached accessory building that contains a garage and a workshop. A 150 square foot addition that will be between the existing residence and that detached accessory building, and a 78 square foot addition at the front of the residence. And they're also proposing to replace the converted garage and workshop with a new 564 square foot two car garage that is deeper than the normal garage. We are doing new entry stairs and site walls, allowing some opportunity for people that are driving along Las Alturas to pull off, or also when you're backing out of the driveway back and not go into the lanes of traffic. The proposal is requiring two modifications, one for a front setback modification because a portion of the new garage will encroach into the required 35-foot front setback, and we need an interior setback modification for the conversion of the existing garage and workshop to habitable space within this required setback. We also have this new stair that comes up from the side of the garage up to the existing area that's a patio at the front of, or I guess it's the existing area in front of the garage. We're creating a little patio area to come into the redesigned front entry. The at the time of the pre-consultation, we discussed the need for a slightly larger than two-car garage because they do have two vehicles as well as a couple of motorcycles that they will be storing in that garage. And this will allow a minimal impact on the public street frontage by keeping it two-car widths wide, but providing the extra depth to provide space for storage of those vehicles. There's also a small alcove that is being dug into the hillside below the stairs, and I believe that's an area that we're going to be storing trash cans and things like that. The reason for this secondary stair to come down is when you're bringing trash out from the house, you can come down the stair into the side of the garage and not have to come down the primary stairs that are being used for the entrance to go into the garage door. So they thought that was important. The project was reviewed at Single Family Design Board on January 27th. The board felt that the modifications were aesthetically appropriate and that the proposed modifications did not pose any consistency issues with the single family residential design guidelines. The board also stated they were supportive of that change of use occurring within the setback. They did ask for a slight change if you were to look on the floor plans. Originally, there's a deck over the garage. Originally, the deck was slightly larger, and they were concerned about the size of the deck, so there's been some discussions back and forth with the board and the applicant about whether or not moving the rail a few feet one direction or another will alleviate their concern. That's really a design issue, so we left that at the design review board. We have a small area of the front of the garage. I'm sorry, this is the that is in the required setback with the landing for the stair that's being cut into the hillside and this small alcove in the side. But because that's below grade, it's not considered an encroachment. I've asked the applicant to further explain that. These are some renderings with a sloped roof. They have a desire to go to a flat roof form that's still not accessible. This lower flat roof is not accessible. So that would be a slight change to what may be encroaching into the setback. We're going from a sloped roof to a flat roof. Staff recommends approval of the modifications and have only one condition related to the stormwater management program, and that the project must comply with Tier 3 stormwater management design issues.
Okay, great, thank you. Would you like to state your name for the record and provide additional comments?
Sure, I'm Dennis Thompson, architect.
And, I'm Marilyn Makepeace, homeowner.
Okay. I'll just give you a little more context of the neighborhood. This is the property here, and while they're almost all of the houses on the uphill side of the street on Las Tunas have a driveway that lifts up off the street to get somewhat behind the setback, but none is as severe as this one. This slope is almost 30%. So that's the real driver of this project, is to get the new garage down closer to the street, closer to a conforming slope. And at the same time, not get any closer to the existing building, because we're going to have to excavate behind this wall to waterproof the wall. We don't want to undermine the garage. So I've left this about 9 feet away. I've left a potential guest parking space of about 25 feet in front of the garage. And the garage itself is about 30 feet deep to allow the cars plus trash storage in this area, plus motorcycles and bicycles. I think 750 square feet is allowed in this zone, so this is under that size. So that's kind of necessitating the front yard modification setback. I do have one more exhibit addressing. This is the existing grade in black here. This is the upper deck. This is the roof, the flat roof area now that's inaccessible. And this is the underside of the stairs, which in plan is here. So that's the area that would be used as storage. It's completely below grade. Mm-hmm. And yes, this is the preferred variation on this. That way we kind of get away from having to have a handrail or guardrail here. I think it's less obtrusive just to have a kind of stone wrap around the side. And we'll go back to SFDB to discuss that change. I think those are my main comments.
Okay, great. Did you want to add anything, or are you just here for?
I'm listening.
Okay, yeah. Okay. I'd like to open a public hearing. There's no one in the audience. Have we received any letters or phone calls? Okay. So I'll close the public hearing. I went out to the site and visited and drove around the neighborhood, get an idea of the setbacks and all that, and I also printed out a thing from our map. Took out the pictures, so it's just an outline of what's there. In regards to your modification request
for the interior setback to allow the conversion of the existing garage and workshop into habitable space. Are there any openings on that wall?
No.
No.
We could look at the plan and just verify that. This is the wall now, so this is, you know, it's the side of the garage, and actually this is partly under grade as it is. No openings. The only one proposed was a skylight to light this bathroom.
Okay.
And we have it slightly in the setback. If need be, we could move it out of the setback.
So this is the egress for code here, and then this one would be up there?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay. Yeah, well, in terms of the conversion of it, from a garage workshop to bedroom, I don't have any concerns with that. I think that's a consistent, appropriate. It's an existing building. You're not adding any new square footage. It's just changing the use and rearranging walls and stuff on the inside. The concern I have is the garage, and that's why I asked Suzanne to let you know that I have concerns and to see, you know, have providing additional information. So when you look at the area, the surrounding area, they all conform to the setback. They're all set back. And asking for a front setback modification, that's kind of significant in this area, is that there's not any, the garage situation you see on the photos provided. This is the neighbor's house. Here's your subject one.
Mm-hmm.
And the front, here's that existing wall, and here's the wall. So the garage is proposing to come out further than that area. And some of the things that we look at in terms of the modifications is, can the project be designed such that the modification is not necessary? In your case, you are requesting an oversized garage in terms of the dimensions. Yes, I know the zoning ordinance allows up to 750 square feet, but that assumes you meet all the other zoning requirements. So just because it says 750 square feet, that doesn't give you the automatic relief of a setback. You still need to conform to all the other sections of the code, like open yard and setbacks and that kind of thing. So the questions I had was, and you answered the one regarding pushing the building back. I didn't know if that was an option because I know you have to over excavate and that kind of stuff. So it seems like you have the minimum distance, the minimum distance that you can have without impacting the existing structure. So I understand that. So the next question is, I realize you want to have a 30-foot deep garage for motorcycles, but reducing it back, I think it's 5 feet at the max here.
Maybe six.
That would still give area. It depends on, I think they're...
Yeah, fine. I thought it was closer to six.
5 foot. That one yeah, shows five.
Five and a half at that corner.
Pushing it or reducing the size by 5 feet to conform to the setback requirements, that is an option.
Well, again, it's trying to get as much storage as we can in the garage for vehicles and for all the other stuff that people have. We can't widen it. Going under the stair, I think it helps a lot. If we go this way, we start to block the entry. I want to keep this pathway up to the entry, trying to stay out of a setback here, although maybe if we could go a little further that way, it would help, since that's all underground.
Yeah, if it's all underground, that wouldn't be an encroachment into the setback. So it would be similar to the storage. If this could be cut down underneath, that wouldn't be considered. It's not, mm-hmm. It's still open from the ground up. So it would be viewed similarly as this here.
Mm-hmm. So we could enlarge this storage area to go
to capture some of the square footage.
And maybe another foot over or something like that.
Yeah, that would be something that you can work out with Suzanne to make sure it meets the zoning ordinance requirements without triggering a modification, but it does seem a plausible option. So in my reviewing the modifications, I understand your desire. I really do, and that's good that you want to hide the stuff instead of having it out and impacting your neighbors that way. But I also have to look at the zoning standards and what the findings are and how we review these kind of things. And typically when I do approve front setback modifications for garages, it's the minimum dimensions, which would be 20 by 20.
Mm-hmm.
Although
This does allow for the larger garage, which then would be a larger dimension. The minimum, absolutely, mm-hmm. is 20 by 20.
Mm-hmm. So then, Marilyn, just so I get this right, the interior garage would be about 25 deep. Cars are about 17 or 18.
Motorcycles are 10. I need 10 feet on a ferry when I reserve ferry. And right now I have two. I will have three. We actually have three cars. So one of them is parked outside anyway.
Well, then that would be, I cannot support an oversized garage in the front setback when there's not any other encroachments right now. It's not consistent with the neighborhood. There's other design issues. So that might mm-hmm. be something Mr. Thompson could look at in terms of redesigning it. I know this is, you know, really pretty, and you don't want to do that or, you know, interfere with that. But I can't support approving a modification for an oversized garage in the front setback. It's just inconsistent with what we've done or what I've done with my decisions.
I think we do have some option to bump out there
to widen that a little, sort of make up for that difference, wide, sort of shift the
shape. I can't say with 100% certainty, but it seems to me since this area here meets the zoning ordinance requirements, although it is within the setback, it's subterranean, mm-hmm. that it would make sense since your slope, mm-hmm. and that's what Suzanne would verify during the plan check process, is that it's still subterranean and, you know, meets our definition of not as looking at that slope.
I think it would be. We would just be coming a little further into the slope to the west. So we could maybe get close to the 600 feet that we have in this design.
I'm not sure. I can ask silly questions because I'm not sure I get it all. So
in other words, we could use this space here, mm-hmm. add that instead of that. So I'd somehow have to figure out how to park three bikes. And so would the stairs be shifted?
Stairs would have to shift back.
So the space would actually be here.
Well, all the way back
instead.
To here. And conceivably, we could bump out another little corner there.
Oh, okay.
That would allow maybe the motorcycles to go in this way. 10 feet.
Yeah, well, I was hoping, you know, if I can get them on a diagonal, it's better. Because then I can get them in and out. It's easier to park. They're big. They're big bikes.
Well, Mr. Thompson's familiar with our zoning ordinance and stuff.
Okay.
And has some ideas on how to deal with it, just in terms of the request mm-hmm. before me with front setback modification.
Okay.
I can't support that part of your okay. project, but this makes absolute sense to me. But you know, then the domino effect is that you do need to replace the parking. And so, you know, I could support this. And then if this either, you know, maybe you could find out that maybe it could shift 2 feet and still not impact this. I'm not saying that's what you have to do, but I think there's plenty of other options that you can look at that would meet our zoning ordinance requirements without requiring the front setback and then also meet.
Okay, so we can massage it and see mm-hmm. what we come up with and see if it works.
Yeah, and like I said, Suzanne could work with you in terms of you know, the zoning requirements and if it meets the definition of not being an encroachment. The other, Suzanne mm-hmm. discussed this area. When I look at this, to me, it's saying parking. I have concern, and you didn't request a front setback modification for parking. And you had said about turnaround, it's not going to help to go down the street, but do you hear, is this all necessary for the?
I would have to defer to Mr. Thompson.
No, I hadn't thought of that as a turnaround. We're not calling it parking. It's an extremely narrow street. You park one car on that street and you have a hazard.
Oh, yeah, I was in a Prius.
Can you imagine a fire truck coming up?
Yeah.
When there's construction going on, it's impossible. So we're not calling it parking. It's a landscaped flat area, mm-hmm. But people will park there and it will be an improvement. But we haven't called it parking.
Okay, can you, I will add a condition that would be noted on the plans not to be used for parking. Just so in the future people see that, they're not going to say, oh, it's parking, have a parking.
Well, that seems unreasonable.
Unreasonable. Okay, then the other thing is that I can't support this part of the project to have the concerns of it being for parking because parking's not allowed in the front setback.
Right, but this isn't even on the agenda, I don't believe. This is not part of the modification.
Okay, I'm approving the site plan. And looking at the site plan in this area here, it doesn't meet the zoning requirements.
So would we put up a sign that says no parking?
No, just note on the site plan.
Okay.
Draw that you submit for building, not to be used for parking.
Okay.
That's all I'm asking is just a note on the plan. I'm not saying signage or anything.
All right.
This is a low wall here. I don't know that you could put a sign on there. Is it 3 feet or something?
Yeah.
It's really low. So no, I'm just asking for a note to be placed on the site plan.
All right.
And also, people coming down those stairs, they need a place to come to the bottom without going right into the road.
I understand all that.
That's a lot of what that's about.
You know, like I said, I parked there, and it was driving a little Prius, and, I stuck out. So I understand it's just for our zoning ordinance.
Yeah.
I mean, you're even not supposed to park in your driveway. People do. We're not going to enforce on that type of thing. But
we have three cars, and what are we, a two-car
garage.
So
this is just recognizing that we don't recognize this as a parking space.
All right.
So with those comments, I can make the finding in the staff report regarding the interior setback modification, but I can't make the finding regarding the front setback modification because there is other design solutions that can be accomplished. And although the site's slope is not really a constraint in terms of the location of the garage, this is the most appropriate place for the garage. It doesn't fit anywhere else. So up front, and that is consistent with the neighborhood, but there's not any significant site constraints that would support the front modification. So that portion of the project is denied. And then Suzanne was proposing the Tier 3 requirements, which you're familiar with. And then I'll add that condition that a note be placed on the plans submitted with the building permits that the favors the area, turnout area there is not to be used as parking or note, just note on the plan. And with that, my action is appealable to the Planning Commission within 10 calendar days. So if you go away and discuss and you decide, you know what, we really want to go forward with it, that's fine. You have 10 days to appeal it. And like I said, with the project beforehand, it's submitted here at our counter versus City Hall. So I don't want you to run around and, for appeal. They also have oversight authority of all my projects. And if they felt this warranted additional discussion before them, that they could call it up during that same 10-day appeal period. And if either of those would occur, Suzanne would contact you. Or if you appealed it, you'd already know, but neighbor or something. Okay?
Okay.
But I adjourn the meeting.
We just have one comment.
Beaucoup, I love you, yeah.